Enjoyed your day at school today. 108 of you here to come along to this session. So as Laura said, for you guys that were here when she mentioned it, my name's Darren Bailey. I work for the Ordnance Survey, and my role at OS is to help teachers and trainee teachers use our materials linked into various curriculums and syllabuses. So I see lots of happy smiling faces, which is good on the screen here. Okay, so with the ones I've got on the screen, any of you guys going to be brave enough to admit you're a geographer? Okay, there's a couple of hands going up. Good, okay. Now, you primary guys will probably hide or turn your camera off when I ask this question, because no one wants to admit to being a geographer. So what we're going to do with the Digimap for Schools website today is this is going to be a getting started session. So showing you some of the things you can do within the service, showing that I said some of the tools, some of the functionalities, and some of the new overlays. I will show some of the new super exciting overlays we've added recently as well, which are really, really good. So what I'm going to do, guys, I'm going to share my screen. If you've got any questions, pop them in the chat. Either myself or Laura will do our best to pick them up. And let's fingers crossed that the technology works perfectly, okay? So hopefully, guys, on the screen, you can see the Digimap for Schools website. If you just want to give me a nod, Laura, that you can see it, that'll be good. Okay. So when you log into the service, guys, the first thing you will see is a map of the UK. So linking into Key Stage 1, Key Stage 2, and of course Key Stage 3 Geography, we can look at place and locations. So in the top left-hand corner of the search places, coordinates or postcodes, we can search and find a mapping location with these. So I'm going to pop in the Ordnance Survey's postcode, and this will zoom me into a street-level detail map, so I can see the OSHQ in the middle, the industrial estate, the motorway, and the housing estate to the right. And I can zoom right in down to this kind of level where I start to see house numbers and house names. So if you're doing this your first time, guys, some of you will be excited. If you log into Ordnance Survey, into Digimap for Schools, and find your house on a map, some of you will be quite excited. And trust me, if you do this with a group of six-year-olds, they'll be incredibly excited about finding their house on a map. So we can look at this kind of level of detail, and we also have some other data sets we can view. Now I'm going to turn on the aerial view, so I can view an aerial image of the Ordnance Survey HQ. So you can view an aerial image for anywhere within Great Britain. So I'm going to start by doing quite a nice little simple task, and I'm going to work out how big the grounds of the Ordnance Survey are. So I'm going to use the measurement tool over on the left-hand side. I'm going to use aerial, and I'm going to click very roughly across the points and coordinates of the OSHQ. And as you can see, it overdraws a little polygon on my map. And when I double click, it will give me my area measurement. So for you guys at Key Stage 1, Key Stage 2, you can link some maths into your geography, because there's obviously a calculation to be made there when we're looking at places and locations. But it means we can find areas for places or size of things in a locality, which is a really nice one to do with those younger pupils. So let's go and do something different. Let's go off and find somewhere in the world. So the biggest addition we've had to this service over the last 18 months or so is the addition of a world map. So I'm going to go and find a map of the centre of Paris. Coincidentally, this is the last place I went on holiday abroad before lockdown happened. So I'm going to zoom into Paris, and it's going to bring me in over Notre Dame Cathedral. So we can view world mapping using something called OpenStreetMap, which gives you these very nice detailed mappings. It's really good for the vast majority of the world. You'll find really good mapping. For cities, you'll find super mapping data sets like this. So what we're going to do is we're going to pinpoint Notre Dame Cathedral, and we're actually going to find the Latin longitude for its location. So when we're looking at coordinates and places in the world, we can find the relevant Latin long for these world places. So using my drawing tools over on the left-hand panel, where we can find all the tools that we can add information to our map, I can click on the one that says grid ref. So when we're in the UK, this will give us a grid reference. When we're on our world map, it will give us the Latin long for a location. So I can choose a setting, a color, and a marker. And this time when I click on my map, you will see it will give me the Latin long for that particular location. So when you're finding these world places, you can find them very easily just by using a simple tool to click on your map and find a location. So I'm going to jump back to the OSHQ. And what we're going to look at, you can see we've got my polygon on the map already. So what we're going to look at is using another very simple drawing tool to draw some information on a map. And what I'm going to do with this one is I'm going to use the line drawing tool to plot a route on a map. So I can come over to my drawing tools on the left-hand panel, come to draw and create. The third tool in is a line drawing tool. Now I can choose my color, my style, and the thickness of the line. So I can choose different color lines to denote different things in a locality. So I'm gonna draw a route, a slightly fictitious route that takes me maybe from this house up to the school here at Oasis Academy. So I'm gonna left click on my map, release that click. And now every time I left click, I can follow or change direction and location. So I can plot along the route that potentially I would take into school, following the pathway on the network, and then coming into the school grounds. So this is a great tool at Key Stage 2 and at Key Stage 3, looking at routes to school. So linking back into pupils' locality and working out where they travel to school. And it's particularly useful because this will help you and help your pupils work out if they have the spatial skills to understand a map, so you can work out which one of your pupils don't have this or have this. So we can plot these fantastic routes on. Now, one really nice addition we've got to this tool is we can work out the distance we travel. So I can come over to the measurement tool under Draw and Create, click on that one, choose metric or imperial. The choice is mine. And if I click on any point on my line, it will measure my distance, he says. There we go. So that route from there is 1.2 kilometers as I travel. So we can start to work into our geography, looking at how do we travel to school, but looking at the distance we travel as well. And of course, if you bring in scale, distance, and measurement into that particular piece of that lesson, you're also bringing in some maps as well. And someone's asked in the chat, can you use line drawing on the aerial view? You certainly can. You can draw your lines on any of the views of the maps we have on here. So when we link in our routes to school, which is a good one to do, we can start to link in the geography of how far is. So you can know how far is it from our school to the center of our town? How far is it from, say, the four capitals of our country? How far is it from London to Edinburgh, to Cardiff, to Belfast, et cetera, et cetera. So you can work out all those distances. Someone's popped in a chat. Can you print this out? We can certainly print it out, which I will show later on in the session as well. So as I said, we've got a really nice world map. So I'm just going to refresh my map. So I take my drawings off my map. And I'm going to zoom it out to show you the extent of the world. So there's a little button under my plus and minus bar, which will zoom me out to show the world. Now we've got two really nice views of the world. The first one is a fantastic physical view of the world. So we can see the Rockies and the Andes, and we can see the Himalayas. Now using the map selector tool on the map, we can actually turn this into an atlas view. So you could use this as an atlas in your classroom to find these places and locations in the world. So I'm gonna overlay one really nice tool to start. So I'm gonna come to my overlay panel on the left-hand side. And I want to see a little bit of geography of how many countries does the equator run through. So on top of my map, I can overlay, I've got the Arctic Circle, the Tropic of Cancer, the equator, the Tropic of Capricorn, and the Arctic Circle. So a nice little bit of geography around, this is probably linked in the Key Stage 2, looking at, you know, where do these particular lines run on a map? So can we work out how many countries the equator runs through, looking at our map? So really nice but simple overlay to show some of those key geographical skills and elements on a map. So I'm just going to turn my lines off. Now, hopefully what we're going to do is we're going to go to Snowdon. So we're going to find ourselves in Snowdon. So we see a lovely 1 to 50k map of Snowdon. So again, coming to symbols and symbolization. So at Key Stage 2, your pupils will need to be able to identify Ordnance Survey symbols on a map, and also probably relevant for Key Stage 3 when you're introducing these skills as well. So over on my left-hand panel, where all my tools are, the second tool down will be one that says Key. Now, as you go through the different Ordnance Survey scales for our maps, there are unique symbols to those scales. Now, with the Key tool here on the left, I can have the symbol sheet that matches the scale of map I have on the screen. So I can view, so if I'm looking for what this V stands for on my map in the center here around Snowdon, I can come down to the tourist information one, and I can see that my blue one here shows me that it's the visitor center. So I can identify the symbols on my map using the key on the left-hand side. You can also print these out if you want physical copies of the symbol sheet. So if you want them to use with your pupils, you can download them out of the service as well. So we can highlight that particular visitor center using the key on the left-hand panel. Now, what I want to do is I want to find the grid reference for that location. So we looked at Paris to find the Latin long. Now we've got two ways we can do this. We can go to our drawing tools and come to my grid reference tool and click on the visitor center, and it will give me the four-figure grid reference for that location. And if you zoom in to a slightly more larger scale, you will also get a six-figure grid reference. One thing you have to be aware of, guys, if you zoom right into a large scale map, which show lots of detail, i.e. your house, you will get a 10 figure grid reference. So before you terrorize your pupils with 10 figure grid references, make sure you find the appropriate scale for 4 and 6 figures. Now, what we can also do is we can actually overlay the British National Grid system on our map. So using our overlay tools on the side here, go into my GB overlay, I can click on the British National Grid, and it will overlay that coordinate system on top of my map. So we can do this. So we got two ways to be able to find grid reference skills. We can do what I would deem it to be the proper way, where we go along the corridor and up the stairs to find our points. Okay, so we can do that on our map, or we can click on locations and find the grid references. So if you're doing a study around your own town or your own city, you want your pupils to identify where the grid references are for locations, you can do that. But if you want to do some grid work using this overlay, you can put that on top of your map and have the complete overlay. What it also tells you guys is, you can see I've got SH on here. This tells me also which 100 kilometer grid square I'm in on the national grid system. So I need to put that in front of my 4 or 6 numbers when I'm doing this. You can also print your maps with the National Grid overlay on top, so you can print it with your Eastings and Northings around it. So if you want to have your pupils to have a physical map with the overlay on, you can print this out as well. So some nice little reference tools there as well for those. So I'm going to turn off my British National Grid. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to zoom my back out to the world. Okay, what I'm going to do this time is I'm going to overlay one of the really super overlays that we have for the world. So this is looking at human geography. So I'm going to overlay the world's time zones. So again, at key stage 2, specifically mentioned in the curriculum, looking at time zones for the world. Okay, but a really nice tool that I have for key stage 3 as well. So I can overlay the time zones, as we can see in the world, and we can see, don't know if you guys know, but there's a 4.5 and a 5¾ time difference in certain places around the world. Now, using the transparency tool, I can fade that in or out, so I can make it more visual by fading it and bringing the transparency right up. So the first thing I can notice is when I look in Russia, I can see there are 9 time zones across Russia. So we can see the vastness of that particular country when we're doing this. So you can see all these particular time zones in the location. Now, what you could do, guys, is a nice little task that I've done is I've created a time zone quiz. So this is about finding places in the world and working out if you can find out the time differences. So here's my time zone quiz, guys. So I've given you a nice easy one to start the quiz. So it's 12 o'clock in England. What time is it in Madagascar? So Madagascar is finding these points and locations on a map. Lots of your pupils would have heard of Madagascar because of the films. So we can see that it's +3 on our particular map. Now, when you get pupils who get really good at this, you can give them a nice tough one, such as if it's 5 o'clock in Moscow, what time is it in Vladivostok? So then they need to better find these places and work out the time differences across these localities. So it's really a nice cross-curricular tool for linking in some maths as well into your geography. So the time zones is a particular favourite one of mine, and it's great for looking at those world elements. Okay, so what we're going to do now, guys, we're going to look at some historical mapping. So in my search here, I'm going to search for Milton Keynes. Okay. Anybody here from Milton Keynes? Okay, before I say something really inappropriate. Okay, thanks very much for waving, Vicky. So that's very good of you. So this is how Milton Keynes is. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at Milton Keynes and look at how it was shown in the 1890s. So anywhere in Great Britain, we can view an historical map in that 1890s period. So it's a great way to link in some history to your geography or some geography to your history, looking at those key geographical things around change over time, settlement patterns and urban sprawl. So we can see how Milton Keynes looked in the 1890s. Now we can also view the 1950s, which is the second era that we've got, so we can see those change across those points. And what we can do with our slider here, guys, is I can start to fade in the current map, and we can see Milton Keynes and all its wonderful roundabouts as we fade it in. So we can show, this is the classic example of urban sprawl in this country. So we can see this kind of change over time, how Milton Keynes has gone from a very small little village into this fantastic city of Milton Keynes. So what I'm going to do on my map to show the kind of area this covers, I'm going to use something called a polygon drawing tool, which I can find under Draw and Create, under my drawing tools, under Shape. And I'm very quickly just going to draw a polygon around what I believe to be the outline of Milton Keynes. Very quickly, like so. So this is how the area that Milton Keynes covers. So can we see what that looks like in the 1890s? Let's fade our 1890s map in. So we can see the area that Milton Keynes was built on. So starting to look at that settlement pattern, that change over time. You know, is the railway line still there? Are there any constants still there from those particular periods? So it's a great little project to do with your pupils as well, is to look at their place and then work out how they can change over time. Someone's just popped into the chat. Can I repeat the actual miss the tabs you clicked? Okay, now on the map selector, I presume on the left-hand panel, all our tabs for our tools. Heather, the drawing tools is at the one at the top. And the one I just used to draw my shape is the shape tool and the polygon drawing tool. To change between my period tabs here or my area, I just click on one of the radio buttons to show me the locations. So quite simple and easy, just a simple one on the map. So that's looking at kind of change over time and those historical implications. So what I'm going to do next, guys, is I'm going to go up to Perth in Scotland. So I'm going to find myself in Perth and Kinross. We're going to have it in today. Okay, so this is what Perth looks like. And we've got the River Tay running through the centre of Perth. So we're going to use a tool. This is a nice little one for you secondary guys to build in some GIS, looking at making those informed decisions using spatial data. We're going to use something on the screen called a buffer tool. Now, a buffer tool will enable us to draw a tool, as it says, with a buffer. So I want to look at the impacts of what would happen and speculate what would happen if the river burst its banks by half a kilometre. So if suddenly we have a huge flood in this location. Now, the software will show you a representation of this. It doesn't have the capability to include things like height, so it's only a speculation, but it gives your pupils a visual of what might happen. So I'm going to come over to my tools over here on the drawing tools. I'm going to click on the buffer tool, which is the little circle with an arrow in, and you need to then create your dialog box to what kind of buffer you're going to draw. So I'm going to draw a line buffer, so I'm going to put a little radio button in line, and I'm going to look at half a kilometre. So from the radius, I'm going to choose 0.5. And from my distance, I'm going to choose kilometre. So I'm going to say to the software, can you draw me a line with half a kilometre either side of my centre line? So what I'm going to do now using this tool is I'm going to click down the River Tay as it runs through Perth. Like so. I'm just going to double click here and it will show me half a kilometre either side. So this is a kind of visual representation of what may happen if this particular river was to burst its banks by half a kilometre. All these locations would actually be underwater. So it's a great way to look at how you can do this, looking at those buffer elements, looking at things like flood and flood and location. Somebody's just posted up, Patricia just posted up, could you do this for coastal erosion? Coastal erosion is the best one to do with this, Patricia. You can look at speculation about what's happening with coastlines around our country. If you go and watch one of the other videos that we've got on here, we do a little bit about coastal erosion. Coast is a really good one to do. Okay, guys, so we've looked at that one. So what we're going to look at now is the most important element that I think you can add to a map, especially if you're introducing the concept of GIS with year seven pupils, is I'm going to link an image to a point or location. So using images to upload to look at place and location, they are without doubt the best one that we can use with these kind of tools. So what I'm going to do, guys, I'm going to find an image of the Ordnance Survey HQ and I'm going to place it and link it to my map. So over on my panel on the left, under Draw and Create here, there's a little tool that says Image. So you can choose any one of your markers here. So you might want to show images of particular things and use a marker to show those. But I'm just going to click on the Ordnance Survey HQ, and it will prompt me then to go and find an image that I want to pin to my map on the hard drive or on your school network. So I'm going to click Browse. And fingers crossed, it takes me straight to my image. Yeah, perfect. So here's my picture of the Ordnance Survey HQ. So I'm just going to say, that's the one I want. Click open. Takes a couple of seconds, and then it will give me the option to upload. So I'm going to click on upload. And what it will do, as you see hopefully on the screen, guys, it will pin an image of the Ordnance Survey HQ to that point or location. So it means you can look at your place in the location, and it's you can add these to your map. Someone said about background noise that I am in our office and there are other people in the office, guys, so I can't unfortunately turn the volume of them down. So hopefully they're not impinging on the recording too much. But what you can see, guys, you can add lots of images. So you can do that route to school and show buildings that people pass on their way, or look at the local buildings in your area and show what those look like on a map. Or if you're doing something around your own school grounds, you know, what are the trees we have around our own school vicinity? Can we take pictures and link them to their point of location? So I'm going to show you a couple of examples here on the screen, guys, of ways you can link maps on. My favorite one, probably definitely relevant Key Stage 2, possibly Key Stage 3. So this is about identifying those Ordnance Survey symbols on a map, so understanding what they show. This is something what we call a symbols walk. So this is about planning a walk in your locality. Okay, so this is about, can I identify how many different Ordnance Survey symbols I can see in our location? So we planned a route here that would take us around as many of these as we can possibly find in a locality. So plan our walk. And as we go on our walk, we're going to capture images of those Ordnance Survey symbols, so we can link them to the symbol on the map. So help your pupils understand what they show. So you can see on my map, guys, we've got a car park, a nature reserve, coniferous trees, we've got a minor road, a major road, a pathway, a church, etc., etc. So linking images to understand Ordnance Survey symbols in a locality. And one really nice thing you can do with these, guys, is anything that is a JPEG image will go into that dialog box. So it means we can create JPEGs, and I'm going to show you a chart in a minute and link it to our map. Someone just asked, when they've pinned images in a location, can each child's map be downloaded and printed? They most certainly can. Whatever you see on your map, you add in the images, you can print those out and use those with your pupils if they're collecting images. So I'm going to show you on the screen, guys, a way to link in some graphed information. So we want to bring things like bar charts in. So this one's looking at, how do we all travel to school? We gave each pupil a marker based on how they travel to school and their mode of transport, created this as a graph, as you can see, as a bar chart. We did this in Excel. In Excel, you could export it as a JPEG image, and then you can link it to your map using that photo tool to add to your map. So you can bring in those kind of bar chart, pie chart elements into your maths as well, into your map as well. And what we want to very quickly look at is the second way you can use images in this particular tool. So I'm going to go and find Buckingham Palace on my map. Now we have a link to a website embedded in this service called Geograph. Now, Geograph is a crowdsourced image library with over 7 million images of the British Isles. And we can use those images and that are already then link and show them on our map. So I'm going to come down to the seventh tool down on my panel on the left, which is the one that says Image Search. And then I can search my Geograph images. Now, I'm going to show all the images on this piece of map that have been collected for the Geograph project in the last 15 years. So I'm just going to put a star in there. It will take a couple of seconds and we will see lots and lots of colored dots appear. So these colored dots are telling me how many images are at these points that have been collected via the Geograph project. So as I zoom in on Buckingham Palace, these images will start to break up. And when I get a little camera icon, it means I can click on that camera icon and view a thumbnail of that map. And then I can click on the thumbnail and show that the picture of Buckingham Palace. So you can use these crowdsourced image libraries that have been collected via the Geograph project over the last 15 years or so and view places and locations throughout the British Isles. So it's a great way to use a secondary source of information with your pupils. So looking at your place, your location, anywhere you're going to visit, looking at urban and rural locations, et cetera, and using these images to explore. And of course, if you go to the Geograph website, guys, you can also upload images and help us build this fantastic project. Someone's asked in the chat, how do you create a collaborate map for all children to add to? Now, what I suggest for this one is when you log in, everyone has their own screen. So you don't see everybody else's screen. So my suggestion for this is hopefully you guys will have lovely interactive whiteboards in your classroom. So you pupils can interact with the whiteboard in the classroom rather than have them all logged in on this on an iPad or a computer. And then you can make your collaborative maps using the interactive whiteboard at the front of the classroom, which is a nice way to bring the whole kind of class into that kind of discussion. Right, guys, I'm going to talk about adding data. So we can add our own kind of information and data to a map. So by this, we mean we can collect data when we're out in a location and link it into what we call a CSV file and a data table and upload it on our map. Now, hopefully, guys, you'll be able to see a little Excel spreadsheet I've popped up on the screen. Doesn't always work, but I've got a little Excel spreadsheet, okay, of points and coordinates and locations. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to add these to my map. So I'm going to come down to the tool, the sixth tool down where it says add your own data. This tells you the options you've got to add information. And I'll show you on the help pages the different types you can do. So I'm going to click browse and I'm going to navigate to my data table that I've collected. I'm going to click open and import. So this should take me to my address, okay, which is over here. And to make this a little bit easier to see, I'm going to actually show this as an aerial image. So this is about recording data. So what we've done with this one, guys, is in around, this is where I live, and during lockdown, I sent one of my daughters out to collect the sound levels in and around our locality. So what I want to do is map the sound during lockdown and see what the difference was between non-lockdown and lockdown time. So you can collect data with your pupils. They can turn it into spreadsheets and instantly make maps of locations. So you can do lots of nice things around your own school grounds. Like you could do sound levels, you could do temperatures, you could do wind speeds, rainfall. You could map all the different trees you've got and finding them and pinning images to them. So it's a great way to introduce this upload of CSV files with your pupils. And for you Key Stage 3, Key Stage 4 guys that have come along to the presentation as well, I'm going to show you an example of how you can link this into Key Stage 4 geography. So again, this is a field trip to a coastal location looking at longshore drift. And this is recording sand heights at groins. So what we did is here, we recorded the points where we were stood. The numbers give the sand heights in centimeters along these locations. And we can put this into a data table, upload it on our map, and it creates that data for us instantly using the information in the data table. So it's a nice, really nice way to add these in. So that's data, okay. Now, what I'm going to do, guys, is I'm going to show you very quickly some of the new overlays that we've added over the last couple of months. Now, I'm quite excited to show these. And with the trainee teachers I've shown these to, they have been incredibly excited about showing these. So I'm going to zoom you out to the extent of the world. Okay. I'm going to come to my overlay panel on the left-hand side. So world physical geography, I'm going to show you all the world's volcanoes. So we can overlay all the volcanoes in the world and their classifications as well, which is really good. So we can see those. So we can see, as that shows us on a global view. Now, what I want to look at as well is where are the tectonic plate boundaries in relation to where these volcanoes are. So we can also overlay the tectonic plate boundaries. So when you're looking at earthquakes or looking at volcanoes, you can show these on the map, which is a fantastic overlay to show your pupils. What we can also show, guys, we can show the major mountain ranges of the world. So if you're looking at those, we can overlay those on our maps, okay, which are really good to see. A really nice one, guys, Key Stage 2, Key Stage 3, we can overlay the world biomes. So the biome classifications, as by the WWF. Someone's just asking, can you zoom in on this? You certainly can. So I can zoom in on a biome. It's just going to go really slow because we're online doing this, guys. That's all. So I can zoom in on a biome. Well, Matt's going to take a few seconds to catch up. Now, I can actually investigate individual biomes. At the top of my map here, guys, up next to the print panel, there's a little investigation tool or information tool. When I click on that one and then click on a biome, it will give me that classification of that biome. So we can see these when we're looking at. So we can look at these. So it's deserts, it shows us tropical rainforests. So you can use and investigate those individual biomes by looking using that information tool at the top. So I'm just going to turn my biomes off. And we also added some human geography. So we've already looked at time zones, but we can also look at population densities. So we can see those on a map. And of course, we will see that India and China look incredibly red. And we can zoom in on those and see those population densities. And a really exciting one, guys, is we've also added world climate details. So when you're looking at climate and we're looking at temperatures, we can show those. So I'm going to, first of all, I'm going to turn on the temperatures as they were between 1970 and 2000. So we can see this overlay on our map. Okay. Now we've got 2010 to 2018, and the projected temperatures for the maximum projected temperatures for 2140. So I'm going to turn that one on. So if we just show the 2010, 2018, if you look at Australia, guys, in the bottom right-hand corner of the map, okay, and these are the projected temperatures that will happen to Australia in 2140. So we can see how much the whole of Australia is going to heat up. So these are a great overlays to use with your pupils looking at those climate and projected climate information as well. Now, what we can also do, guys, is we can do the same thing for precipitation. So we can look at the increase of rainfall as well across the world, or the decrease of rainfall, of course, as well across the world. So some fantastic overlays linked into lots of those geography. You'll cover Key Stage 2, Key Stage 3, and Key Stage 4. So let's talk about a couple of things that have been mentioned. We've already mentioned about printing maps. At the top, guys, there's a print panel, a print button. If you print on that, if you click on there, whatever you see in your layout is what you'll print out. You get your layout view as well. You can give it a title, put your name on it, you give it an exact or a rounded scale. You can print it A4, A3, portrait or landscape. You can add a legend as well. If you're in the UK, you can overlay your British National Grid system. Now, what it will actually do, guys, it creates a PDF or a JPEG, so it creates a file for two reasons. One, just to stop your pupils hitting the print button and running out your ink cartridge. But two, it means you can save these files onto the network at the school and use them and come back to them for the pupils' work. And anything you see in the service, you can print. So any of the layers, any of the historical layers, any of the information you layer on top of your map. So you can print those on your map. You can also save your maps within the save tool on the left-hand panel. You will get a 4-number pin that comes with your login, which is an administrative number, which means you can create a Windows file structure for your pupils to save their maps into. So you can save your maps and your pupils can save maps within the service. And also within the service, guys, at the top is a little help button. So if you're ever struggling with any of the tools inside, we can click on the help button and this will show you all the help tools. So if we're looking at adding our own data, which we did for our sound levels, this tells you the formats you can use and the layouts and information that you can add into your particular file there. So all those stuff that I've shown today, there will be a little help tip within there to help you with this. And just to round off the session, guys, Shannon's just said, can you download maps on iPads? Shannon, this is all web-based. So as long as you have a browser, either on your iPad, your tablet, your laptop, your computer, you can run the service. So it's all web-based. And I'm just going to jump outside the login, guys. I'm going to come to a link that says Digimap Schools at the top. This will bring us back into the homepage. Now, under help and resources, we've got lots of free resources you can use to access some ideas. So we work very closely with the Geographical Association, Subject Association for Geography, working with their primary and secondary leads. And there's lots of little resources, booklets, ideas for teachers new to geography or new to Digimap for Schools to come along and use some of these ideas linked into the various curriculums and syllabus. And these are relevant for both England, Scotland and Wales, particular ones for Scotland. And the final two things, someone's just asked, does their each child their own login? Emma, you have a username and password that covers the whole school. But when you individually, when each pupil logs in, they will have their own screen, okay? to do that. Someone's asked, they've struggled to zoom out. I'll come back and answer that question at the end. And one for Tanya, I will as well answer that one at the end. I just want to show you two links at the bottom of the page here, guys. Under Follow Us, there is a YouTube channel. So there's a Digimap for Schools YouTube channel, which is where this one will be actually, this will be posted up as well. So we create lots and lots of videos with content. So all our previous webinars are here, guys. If you want to come back and look at some of the other previous webinars, they're all here. But all those ideas, some of the stuff we showed today, how to use your British National Grid, how to overlay your maps, how to change your historical maps, how to use the geograph images, little bite-sized 10, 15, 20-minute videos for you to come back to. And the final one, guys, and then I will go through and answer some of the questions. Other one is the Twitter link, where you hopefully you may have seen the link here or the advertisement of this particular webinar. Using Twitter, what we're trying to do, guys, is we're trying to get teachers to tweet and tell us how they're using this service in the classroom. Now, peer-to-peer examples are way more powerful than anything we can do for you. So at your own leisure, guys, have a look through this Twitter link. There are some fabulous ideas, teachers telling us how they're using us to look at the geography and history of their location using this tool. And the vast majority of these are from a primary school guys. So if there's any secondary teachers out there, please tweet in and tell us how you're using it with your pupils so we can share this with the secondary community as well. And there's reams and reams of ideas here, guys. So come back and have a look at these at another time. So I'm just going to work through some of the questions I haven't answered here, guys. So Emma said, I'm struggling to zoom out as far as you've shown. So let me just log back into the service. There's a little button, Emma, underneath the plus and minus bar. So that little icon there underneath the plus and minus bar, if I click on that one, that will zoom me out to show the extent of the world. So that's as far as we can zoom out on the map. Okay, so that's quite an easy one. Tanya's asked, will you be introducing some for early years? Now, funny you should say that, Tanya. We've just had some guidance written by a primary school specialist around the new early year curriculum and framework. So we have quite an extensive document that we'll be publishing early in February, which will cover maps and mapping in early years. There's already a primary version. Let's show you while I've got this on the screen. Let's show this one. That's there for you guys for year one and year six, which you'll find under using Digimap for Schools. It's a fantastic document. Where have you moved to pull this document? Yeah. Oh, here we go. Right in front of my eyes. The plan of your pupil progression one. Okay, so year five to year 11, a awesome document, a geographical association one document about using maps and mapping throughout Key Stage 1, Key Stage 2, creating your curriculum progression, that magical word progression, and also linked into the Ofsted framework around looking at maps as well. Now, Amanda's asked, can you overlay maps from a different era? Currently, Amanda, we only have the 1890s and the 1950s. Okay, so as soon as data sets become available that have national coverage, because we have to have the whole of England, Scotland and Wales, we will endeavour to make them available. So as these data sets become available, we will endeavour to add them to the map as well. So there'll be more historical layers. Someone's asked, how do you remove a route you've plotted? So let's show that one on the map as well. So let's go back in. So you've got a couple of options for doing this. So let's very quickly just draw a line across the UK, like so. So you can either, if you just want to turn it off so you can show it. So there's a little button here, radio button at the top that says show your drawings. If you just want to turn your drawings off, you can click on the radio button, it will turn them off. If you want to actually delete them and remove them, under delete here, we've got two options. So you can delete all, which will clear your map of everything, or you can delete by click. So I'm going to delete by click, highlight that one, click on what I want to remove from my map, and it removes it from my map. Yes, this webinar will be posted up. Okay, guys. So that was a very brief introduction to some of the things you can do within Digimap for Schools. When you go in and play yourself, guys, there are loads of fantastic geography you can link in using this fantastic tool. Lots of cross-curricular options as well. So looking at history, math, science, etc., etc. Have a look at the resources. Come and have a look at the rest of the webinars we've got on the YouTube channel if you're looking for ideas as well.